فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
الحمد لله رب العالمين، له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل، وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين، أما بعد. إن شاء الله تعالى, today I will be doing the lecture of Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah. In order to prepare this lecture, I read 10 different books, and the notes that I wrote are 513 pages. And I won't be able in any way, form or shape to go over all of that. And inshallah ta'ala, the books that have been written about Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah's life are categorized into two. Books which are tarajum, which are mufrada. Books which are specifically written on his life. And those are, inshallah ta'ala, the ones I'm going to mention. The best of them is the kitab written by Al-Hafidh Muhammad ibn Ahmad ibn Abdul Hadi al-Maqdisi, rahimahullah. He wrote a kitab called Al-Uqood al-Durriya fi dhikri ba'd manaqib Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah. Ibn Abdul Hadi, rahimahullah, he died when the year was 744. He lived only for 39 years. And Ibn Abdul Hadi was the person that Abu al-Hajjaj al-Mizzi said that whenever Ibn Abdul Hadi would enter onto me, whenever he would come in and meet me, I, Abu al-Hajjaj al-Mizzi, would benefit from him. He was a person of great caliber in knowledge. Rahimahullah. And Ibn Abdul Hadi was from the students of Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah. And there's many books. There's a kitab called الصارم المنكي في الرد على السبكي, where he refused تقي الدين السبكي. 39, very young. He was a peer of Ibn Kathir, rahimahullah. Him and Ibn Kathir were students together, and they used to study from Abu al-Hajjaj al-Mizzi and Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah. He wrote a book on the life of Ibn Taymiyyah. It's the best book written. The second kitab is called Ad-Durratul Yatimiyyah في سيرة ابن تيمية, and it's written by الإمام الذهبي رحمه الله. الإمام الذهبي is from the students of Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, and he authored a book talking about the biography of ibn Taymiyyah. الإمام الذهبي is غني عن التعريف, he's very well known. There's no need to discuss who he is. The third book that's specifically written on ibn Taymiyyah's life is the كتاب الأعلام العليّة في مناقب شيخ الإسلام ابن تيمية, and it's written by أبي حفص عمر ابن أبو حفص sorry عمر ابن علي البزار, who died the year 749 هجرية. The fourth scholar that wrote a book specifically on ابن تيمية's life is حافظ ابن كثير رحمه الله. ابن كثير's book, he mentioned that he wrote the life of ابن تيمية, but it's not found. He mentions this in his kitab Al-Bidayah wa-Nihayah, that he's going to specifically, after he spoke about Ibn Taymiyyah in his kitab Al-Bidayah wa-Nihayah, he says, I'm going to write a biography on him. But what happened was, either he forgot to write it, or he wrote it and it's from the books that were lost, or he got busy writing it. Whatever the reason may be, we haven't got that book that Ibn Kathir wrote. One of the books that are written is Manaqib ibn Taymiyyah, written by Al-Hassan ibn Umar ibn Hassan ibn al-Habib. And this kitab is still makhtoot. It's not published yet. Al-Qasidatu al-Ta'iyya fi inkari takfir ala al-Bukhari ibn Taymiyyah. And this is written by Umar ibn Musa al-Himsi, al-Shafi'i. He wrote a hundred lines of poetry in speaking about the Prophet, speaking about Ibn Taymiyyah's biography in poetry and defending him. Ala al-Bukhari, he made takfir of Ibn Taymiyyah, and he said he's a kafir. So he came and he defended him. Number 7 is al-intisaru fi dhikri ahwali qami'u al-mubtadi'ina وآخر المجتهدين. It's written by عبد الرحمن المقدسي الحنبلي. Number 8 is الرد الوافر على من زعم أن من سمى ابن تيمية شيخ الإسلام كافر. And it's written by ناصر الدين الدمشقي. This كتاب مكتبة الإسلامي published it with the تحقيق of زهير الشاويش. And it's one of the best books written on his biography. This book, الرد الوافر, Ibn Hajar saw it. When Ibn Hajar saw it, he requested the book and Ibn Hajar wrote something on it. He made a taqreed on it. And on there, Ibn Hajar praises Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah. And inshallah ta'ala, if time gives us, inshallah, we'll bring the kalam of Ibn Hajar about Ibn Taymiyyah and how he praised him. Rahimahullah. And this book, الرد الوافر, is a refutation of Ala al-Bukhari, who said that no one could call Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah. Can't call him Shaykh al-Islam. Because he's a kafir, you can't call him Shaykh al-Islam. If you call him, then you become a kafir, he said. So it was a response by Nasiruddin al-Dimashqi. The ninth book is Al-Ikhtiyarat al-Mardiyah fi Akhbari Taqi ibn Taymiyyah. And it's written by Muhammad ibn Ali ibn Tulun al-Hanafi, who died the year 953 Hijriya. Last but not least, Al-Shahadatu al-Zakiyyah fi Thana'i al-A'immati ala ibn Taymiyyah. And it's written by Mar'i al-Karmi al-Hanbali. These books are 10 books from 30 odd books that are written on his life. For me to go through everything about Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah, his life is going to be very hard, all of it. But inshallah ta'ala, what we aim to do is qatafat, points here and there, lessons that we can take from him, rahimahullah. I want to start by saying inshallah ta'ala, that Ibn Taymiyyah was called Shaykh al-Islam. So what is Shaykh al-Islam? That will give us an understanding of the title Shaykh al-Islam, and they will know what quality he holds. Nasiruddin al-Dimashqi in his kitab al-Radd al-Wafir, he defines what Shaykh al-Islam means. And he says the following. He says, he mentions many meanings, and then he says, وَمِنْهَا أَنَّ مَعْنَاهُ الْمَعْرُوفُ. The meaning that is known amongst the al-Jahabidat al-Nuqad, the scholars of hadith. عند أئمة الإسناد, the scholars of hadith who deal with hadith, when they use the word term Shaykh al-Islam, they mean by it. هم المتبعون للكتاب, those who follow the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. المقتفون لسنة رسول صلى الله عليه وسلم, and they tread on the path of the sunnah of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. الذين تقدموا بمعرفة أحكام القرآن ووجوه قراءاته, those who have preceded everybody else in knowing the أحكام of the Quran and the قراءات. وأسباب نزوله, and they know the reasons why the Quran came down, every verse where it came down, that's the sabab al-nuzul. وَنَاسِخِهِ وَمَنْسُوخِهِ, every verse they know, if it's abrogated, which verse did he abrogate, or what verse abrogated it. وَالْأَخْذِ بِآيَاتِ الْمُحْكَمَاتِ, and they take the verses which are clear-cut. وَالْإِيمَانِ بِالْمُتَشَابِهَاتِ, and they believe in the vague, ambiguous verses. وَقَدْ أَحْكَمُوا مِنْ لُغَةِ الْعَرَبِ, they've mastered the Arabic language. مَا أَعَانَهُمْ عَلَى عِلْمِ مَا تَقَدَّمْ, it helps them and supports them in understanding the Quran and the Sunnah. وَعَلِمُوا السُّنَّةَ نَقْلًا وَإِثْنَادًا, they know the Sunnah in terms of its chain, and they know it in terms of its wordings. They know it. وَعَمَلًا, they also implement the hadith of the Prophet. بِمَا يَجِبُ الْعَمَلُ بِهِ اعْتِمَادًا, they implement what's in the hadith. As much as they know its riwayat and the chains and the turuq and the meaning, they also implement it. They are known to implement it. وَإِيمَانًا, they believe in it. They're also known for that. وَاسْتِنْبَاطًا, they're also able to extract from it. لِلْأُصُولِ وَالْفُرُوعِ, matters of aqeedah, they can extract rulings out of it. For fiqh issues, they can also extract rulings out of it. قَائِمِينَ بِمَا فَرَضَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِمْ, they stand to establish what is obligatory on them. مُتَمَسِّكِينَ بِمَا سَاقَهُ اللَّهُ مِنْ ذَلِكَ إِلَيْهِمْ, and they also are holding on to every knowledge Allah gave them. They are implementers of it. مُتَوَاضِعِينَ لِلَّهِ الْعَظِيمِ الشَّأْنِ, they are very humble individuals. They are known to be very humble. خَائِفِينَ مِنْ عَثْرَةِ اللِّسَانِ, they are also scared of the slip of the tongue. They avoid mistakes. And they fear doing mistakes. لَا يَدَّعُونَ الْعِصْمَةَ, they don't claim that they are infallible. وَلَا يَفْرَحُونَ بِالتَّبْجِيلِ, and they are never happy to be bragged and boasted and raised up. They don't like big titles. عَالِمِينَ أَنَّ الَّذِي أُوتُوا مِنَ الْعِلْمِ قَلِيلٍ, they also know that knowledge the knowledge that has been given to them is very little. فَمَنْ كَانَ بِهَذِهِ الْمَنْزِلَةِ, anyone who has these characteristics, حُكِمَ بِأَنَّهُ إِمَامٌ, he's referred to as Imam. وَاسْتَحَقَّ, and he deserves, أَنْ يُقَالَ لَهُ شَيْخَ الْإِسْلَامِ, and he has the rights for him to be called Shaykh al-Islam. That gives you an understanding of why he was called Shaykh al-Islam. These characteristics, are they present in him or not? You will see. Let's start, inshaAllah ta'ala, with his biography, rahimahullah ta'ala. He is Ibn Taymiyyah Ahmed, that's his name. His kunya is Taqiy al-Din. That's his laqab. His kunya is Abu al-Abbas. He's the son of Shihabuddin Abdul Halim, who is the son of Al-Sheikh Abdul Salam Majduddin Abil Barakat Ibn Abdullah Ibn Taymiyyah. Ibn Taymiyyah was born in Harran on Monday, the 12th of Rabi' al-Awwal. He was born on the 12th of Rabi' al-Awwal on Monday. Nabiullah Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He was born the same, on a Monday, same day as the Prophet. And he was born on the same date as the Prophet. And in the same month of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Alayhi salatu wa sallam. And this is a good sign for him. Rahimahullah rahmatan wasi'a. The Shaykh rahimahullah, he stayed in the place of his birth, Harran, until he reached 7 years of age. Then he and his father and his brothers, they moved to Dimashq. Why? Firaran min zahf al-Tatar. They ran away from the Tatar, who were the Mongols, and their oppression towards the Muslims. Ibn Taymiyyah's father, Shihabuddin Abdul Halim, Ibn Taymiyyah's father, Abdul Halim, whose kunya or his laqab was Shihabuddin, he was a scholar in and within himself. Qara al-Madhab al-Hanbali. His father studied the madhab of the Hanbali madhab on his father. Hatta atqadahu, until he mastered his father. And this shows us the importance of studying a madhab and grounding yourself upon a madhab from the beginning and then making your way up. He, rahimahullah, he studied the madhab al-Hanbali on his father. حتى أتقنه, until he mastered it. ودرس وأفتى وصنف. His father used to teach. His father used to have a seat where he would do fatwas, and his father was known to author. His father was an imam. He was a muhaqqiq, and he mastered many funun. His father was mutawadu, a very humble man. حسن الأخلاق. His father had good etiquettes and good manners. جوادن. His father was a very generous man, known for his generosity. His father, rahimahullah, al-Imam al-Dhahabi said he was known as, Ibn Taymiyyah's father was known as Nurul Qamar, the light of the moon, Ibn Taymiyyah's father. And his son, Ibn Taymiyyah, was known as Daw al-Shamsi, the light and the ray of the sun. Al-Shaykh Abdul Halim, he took the Mashyakha to Dar al-Hadith in Sukariya. Back in those days, there were madaris, there were schools. And at that time, the person, in order to be a teacher, there was a lot of levels of scholastic knowledge-based ilm, tadqiq, he had to go through. And Shaykh al-Islam, his father, went through that. He used to have a sit where he used to teach. And his father never ever read from a paper. His father, كان يقرأ من حفظه. He used to read from the top of his head, and he would come on Fridays and his father would teach. As for Shaykh al-Islam's granddad, his granddad is Majduddin Abu al-Barakat Abdul Salam Ibn Abdullah Ibn Taymiyyah al-Harrani. He is known as Faqih al-Hanbali, the Faqih the Hanbali, rahimahullah. He was a muqri, qari in qiraat, muhaddith, mufassir, usuli, nahwi, ahad al-huffad al-a'lam. His granddad was a qari, he had a qiraat. He also was a muhaddith, a scholar in hadith. He was a mufassir, and he was an usuli, and he was a grammarian. And he was graded and classified as one of the huffad in hadith, his granddad. And his granddad is the author of the kitab Al-Muntaqa, which is the sharah of Nailul Awtar by Shawkani. His granddad, Ibn Taymiyyah. ولذلك Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah, he spoke about his granddad, and he said, كان جدنا, our granddad, he was عجباً في حفظ الحديث, how his memorization was in hadith. وسرديها, how he could transmit the hadith and just read it like that. وحفظ مذاهب الناس, how he knew the madhabs and the scholars of the madhabs, their aqwal and their statements. And all of that, he knew it without any mashaqqah and any kulfa. He wouldn't have to think. And is it? No. All of that would just be flowing from him. Jamaluddin Ibn Malik, you know the grammarian Ibn Malik. Ibn Malik was at the same time as Ibn Taymiyyah's granddad. And Ibn Jamaluddin Ibn Malik, and he said about Ibn Taymiyyah's granddad, he said, "Ulina li Shaykh al-Majd al-Fiqh kama ulina li Dawood al-Hadid." Fiqh was made so soft for Ibn Taymiyyah's granddad, just like Allah made the metal soft for Nabiullah Dawood. The way Allah made وَأَلَنَّا لَهُ الْحَدِيدِ, then Allah said, we made the metal soft for Nabiullah Dawood, that if Dawood grabbed the metal, he would bend it. Nabiullah Dawood. Allah gave fiqh to Ibn Taymiyyah's granddad, that he was able to do that with fiqh, use it in any way he wanted it. He was ma'dumun nadir. Rare would you find somebody like his granddad, Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah. Why was his family known as Taymiyyah? Why? What's the reason and what's the story behind it? The scholars, they differ on where this term Taymiyyah came from. Some of the scholars, they mention that his granddad, which is Muhammad ibn al-Khadir, Muhammad ibn al-Khadir, who is the granddad of Abd Salam. Oh, sorry, the uncle of Abd Salam. Who's Abd Salam? Ibn Taymiyyah's granddad. So that's his granddad's uncle, whose name is who? Muhammad ibn al-Khadir. He went to do Hajj in a place called Darbu Tayma. He saw there a young girl, Tifla ismaha Taymiyyah. Her name was known as Taymiyyah. So when he came back, فَرَجَعَ ثُمَّ رَجَعَ فَوَجَدَ مَرَأَتَهُ, he found his wife was pregnant. And when he found, Muhammad ibn al-Khadir found his wife was pregnant, so he called his daughter Taymiyyah. And so then it passed on to the family. And so that's why they were called Taymiyyah. That's one view. The second view is that the grandmother of Muhammad ibn al-Khadir, his grandmother, she was a wa'idah, a woman who was known to do good reminders. And her name was Taymiyyah. So the family was named after that. What we can take from that is Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, he came from what? Usrah ariqah fil ilm. A family that is truly rooted in what? Truly rooted in knowledge. And that's where he came out from, rahimahullah ta'ala. Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, as I said before, he moved from Harran, which is his place of birth, and he went to Dimashq. And why he went to Dimashq was the fear of the Tatar, the Mongolians, and their oppression towards the Muslim. Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah's father and his brothers, they went. And Ibn Taymiyyah's father, he brought all of his books with him, and he placed it on his riding beast. And they were leaving with the books, and it was so heavy. The path, the road, was full of the enemies. The Tatar were grabbing the people and they were killing them. And Shaykh al-Islam, his father, was a muta'abbid, a worshipper of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But knowing that the books are with him, not leaving one of his books, and it will slow them down, he never left it behind. How much he loved his knowledge. And Shaykh al-Islam's father, if it wasn't for, as Imam Ibn Abdul Hadi mentions, لَوْلَا أَنَّهُمْ اسْتَعَانُوا بِاللَّهِ تَعَالَى, if it wasn't for the fact that Ibn Taymiyyah's father was really asking Allah for help and aid, and he begged Allah the way he did, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala might have thrown him into the hands of the enemies. Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, his father came to Dimashq. He ran away from Harran and they made it to Dimashq. When they came to Dimashq, Ibn Taymiyyah's father straight away, he took over the teaching. As I said before, he took over the Mashyaqatul Hadith al-Sukariya. He had to sit there and he would teach. Rahimahullahu rahmatan wasi'ah. Ibn Taymiyyah as a young kid would run around, see his father in the halaqa teaching and educating the people. And Ibn Taymiyyah would sit down and he would take from his father. And as I said before, وَكَانَ أَبُوهُ يُلْقِي دَرْسَهُ مِنْ حِفْظِهِ, his father would teach from memory. مِنْ غَيْرِ اسْتِعَانَةٍ بِقَرَاطِيسِ, without any scrolls being placed in front of him. لِقُوَّةِ ذَكِرَتِي, how strong the memory of Ibn Taymiyyah's father was, rahimahullah. And his granddad was like that. And in no way or form or shape are we shocked and amazed to know that Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah is going to be like that. Rahimahullah ta'ala. His father pushed Ibn Taymiyyah to memorize the Quran. And wallahi, I have to stop here and pause. Ibn Abdul Hadi said, أول ما اتجه إلى القرآن. Pay attention to this. The first thing that Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah embarked on is the Quran. فَحَفِظَهُ, he memorized it. ثُمَّ لَمْ يَنْسَ بَعْدَهُ, and he never forgot it after that. Ya ikhwa, wanting to be a student of knowledge and not memorizing the Quran, it is as I used to hear from my father, فَمَنْ ضَيَّعَ الْقُرْآنَ, anyone who forsakes the Quran, فَلِمَا سِوَاهُ أَضْيَعَ, he is going to forsake everything else. If you couldn't give time to the statement of Allah, then truly what are you going to give importance to? If you couldn't memorize the speech of Allah, you don't read a biography of a scholar, except the first thing that's mentioned from him is what? He gave importance to the Quran. He memorized the Quran. Ibn Taymiyyah started his life with the Quran, and when he died, inshallah ta'ala, as we're going to see, the last thing that he had, the last thing he was reading was the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he died reciting the ayah. He reached Suratul Qamar, and he reached the ayah, إِنَّ الْمُتَّقِينَ فِي جَنَّاتٍ وَنَهَرٍ فِي مَقْعَدِ صِدْقٍ عِنْدَ مَلِيكٍ مُقْتَدِرٍ. That was the ayah Shaykh al-Islam died. 81 times he finished the Quran. And Ibn Taymiyyah regretted it. All of his years of what he was doing, he regretted it. He said, why didn't I spend my time with the Quran? Why didn't I spend my time with the Quran? So this shows us and it gives us an understanding that if you want to study and if you want to learn, the first step for learning and educating yourself is going for the Quran, without a shadow of a doubt. وَلِذَلِكَ the previous ulama, when a student would come to them and wants to study with them, the first thing they would say to him is, have you memorized the Quran? If he says no, they would say, I don't have time to teach you. Go memorize the Quran and come back to me. But we've put the standard down. So we teach anybody who comes to us, no problem, we just teach them. But the truth of the matter is that the Quran is number one. وَلِذَلِكَ Shaykh al-Islam became Shaykh al-Islam is because he memorized what? He started with the memorization of the Quran. Ibn Taymiyyah was known to rarely forget something. He wouldn't read and forget something he memorized. Even at his last stages, Shaykh al-Islam rarely forgot what he memorized. Rahimahullah. He used to do istishhadat of the verses of the Quran. Now he would use an ayah that he needed, as though Ibn Abdul Hadi said that the Mus'haf was right in front of him. And he was looking at the Mus'haf. And he would read the ayah like that when he needed it, rahimahullah. فَكَأَنَّمَا يَنْظُرُ فِي مُصْحَفٍ مَنْشُورٍ بَيْنَ يَدَيْهِ. He would read the verse that he wants to use, like the Mus'haf was placed in front of him, rahimahullah. But rather, what's even amazing is that, rahimahullah, that he didn't just stop at the Quran. He took it a step further. He memorized hadith. He memorized fiqh books and mutun. He memorized books of the language. And Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah bara'a fi nahwi bara'atan khasatan. Ibn Taymiyyah became deep in the Arabic language, that he read the Kitab Sibawayh. And he read it بتأمل. He sat down and he opened it and he read it easily, rahimahullah ta'ala. And when he read it, he was studying it and he found points he didn't agree with. Rahimahullah rahmatan wasi'a. And as Imam Ibn Abdul Hadi said, فَيُخَالِفُ بَعْضَ مَا فِيهِ مُعْتَمِدًا عَلَى مَا دَرَسَ فِي غَيْرِي. Points that he differed with him and he disagreed with him. Rahimahullah, he would point them out. And Ibn Taymiyyah, فَلَمْ يَكُنْ مِنَ الْمُتَهَمِّجِينَ. Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah, he was not from those people who would wage enmity towards somebody مِنْ غَيْرِ بَيِّنَةٍ, without evidence that he believed which was right. Whether you agreed with his evidence or something else, but he believed evidences that he had. رَحِمَهُ رَحْمَةً وَاسِعَةً. Ibn Taymiyyah, rahimahullah, as a young child, he spent his time فِي الْجِدِّ وَالِجْتِهَادِ. He worked hard and he put a lot of efforts in. Ya ikhwa, the people differ. People want to be of that caliber, but they don't want to put no efforts in. People differ, ya ikhwa. At times when people sleep and they go to sleep, if you want to be different, you have to be different by not sleeping. You shouldn't be doing what the other people are doing if you want to be different from the people. You need to do things that people don't do when it comes to working hard and putting effort in. And Shaykh al-Islam, as a young individual, he had that. He had ijjid and ijtihad, rahimahullah. He finished the Quran at a young age. And then he memorized hadith and fiqh and Arabic. Brothers, pay attention to this. The books that Ibn Taymiyyah studied and learnt, wallahi, qalla man yaqra'uha. Little are those who even read it, let alone study it. The books that he read was Musnad Imam Ahmad. And Musnad Imam Ahmad is 30 volumes. Shaykh al-Islam read that. He read Sahih al-Bukhari, Sahih al-Muslim, Jami' al-Tirmidhi, Sunan ibn Abi Dawud, al-Sijistani, al-Nasa'i, Ibn Majah, Darqutni. He, rahimahullah, heard this not once, not twice, but over 40 times, rahimahullah, these books. Who from amongst us has ever opened Sahih al-Bukhari and looked at it? Rahimahullah. Every kitab, Ibn Taymiyyah, he had istihdar of it. He would be able to use it. And the first book of hadith that he memorized is not 40 hadith, is not Umdatul Ahkam and Bulugh al-Maram. La. The first kitab that he memorized was Al-Jam'u Bayn al-Sahihayn by Humaydi. And this book is 4 volumes right now, published 4 volumes. Published with what? Arba' Mujalladat. Shaykh al-Islam, he memorized that, rahimahullah. He sat down and he took from his teacher, Ibn Abdi Da'im al-Maqdisi, and knows of that, he's of that level. Rahimahullah, qira'atan wa sama'an. He would go and he would listen to the ahadith being read on him, rahimahullah, rahmatan wasi'a. He studied Al-Mu'jam al-Tabarani al-Kubra, Kabir. Nobody looks at those books today. He read it, he gave inayah to it. Then Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, he went towards ala tafsir iqbalan kulliyan. He turned towards tafsir, rahimahullah. Hatta haza fi qasb al-sabq. Until he surpassed his peers and those of his level. Ibn Taymiyyah mastered usul al-fiqh, rahimahullah, rahmatan wasi'a. And guess what? He wasn't even 17 years of age when he done all of that. Wa huwa ba'du ibn bid'a 10 sana. It was only 17 maximum, Ibn Taymiyyah, when he did this. Rahimahullah, rahmatan wasi'a. What do our 17-year-olds do? Chicken and chip shops. Yeah? That's our 17-year-olds. Like, look at him, rahimahullah ta'ala, taking all of this responsibility on himself. Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah darasa fiqh al-Hanbali. He studied what? Those people who want to study a fiqh and speak about masail fiqhiyya, who haven't studied upon a madhab, this is yat'abun. Wallahi, they will get it. It will be very hard for them. And every imam that you see, he started with a madhab. And then he became an imam, which is mujtahid, mutlaq. And everybody just likes to look at the last stages of that imam and think that's the right way of studying. And that's not the way. That's not the way. Shaykh al-Islam studied with the Hanbali madhab. And he loved Imam Ahmad, rahimahullah. So he did tatabbu' and he followed up Imam Ahmad, rahimahullah. After that, he differed with him what he differed with him, and he had his own views, Shaykh al-Islam. But he started with a madhab. Ibn Taymiyyah, when he passed the age, 20 years of age, his father died. And as soon as his father died, he knew the responsibility was on him to take his father's seat. And he sat down and he sat on his father's seat. And he was only 20 years of age, teaching and carrying on from where his father left off. Rahimahullah. Shaykh al-Islam. Fajalasa. He sat down. And at that time when Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah is sitting down and he's teaching, there are ulama kibar. It's not a time like, huh? Like here, where is? There are ulama, ibn al-Daqiq al-Eid and others are alive, who are ulama of their caliber, of their father's caliber, who are alive at that time. Ibn Taymiyyah, a 20-year-old, is sitting in the seat. Rahimahullah, rahmatan wasi'a. Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, he was an individual who had qawiyu tawakkul. He used to rely on Allah excessively. Da'im with dhikr. He used to remember Allah a lot. He used to have adhkar, which he would never leave. Rahimahullah. And he would never be heedless of. His student, Ibn al-Qayyim, said, حضرت شيخ الإسلام ابن تيمية مرة. I came to شيخ الإسلام ابن تيمية one time. صلى الصبح. He prayed صلاة الصبح. فجر. ثم جلس. He sat there. He didn't move. يذكر الله. He was remembering Allah. قريب من منتصف النهار. Until it reached half the day. ثم التفت إلي. And then he looked at me, ابن القيم. He looked at ابن القيم. And he said to ابن القيم, هذه غدوتي. This is my breakfast. This dhikr. This is my breakfast. وَلَوْ لَمْ أَتَغَدَّ If I don't have this breakfast and I don't eat, I don't do this, سَقَطَتْ قُوَّتِ My strength goes. If I don't do this dhikr and I don't remember Allah, I no longer will have strength. أو كَلَامًا قَرِيبًا مِنْ هَذَا He said, Ibn al-Qayyim said, or speech close to that, he said to me. وَقَالَ لِي مَرَّ He said to me one day. He said to him one day, لَا أَتْرُكُ الذِّكْرَ If you ever see me leave off a dhikr that I should have done, I've only left it to relax so I can come back and I can do it more later. He said this to him, rahimahullah ta'ala. Who is the person who's been said this to? Is the doctor of the hearts, Ibn al-Qayyim, alayhi rahmatullah. And Ibn al-Qayyim mentions this in his kitab al-Wabil al-Sayyib, in the dhikr when he's talking about the adhkar. Ibn al-Qayyim was amazed with who? Ibn Taymiyyah. Rather, one time, Ibn al-Qayyim said, Rumma Ibn al-Qayyim said to Ibn Taymiyyah, said to his student Ibn al-Qayyim, Rubbama tala'tu, I might look at sometimes al-ayat al-wahida, one verse, I might look at mi'at tafsir. I will look at 100 books of tafsir. One verse, I want to know what it means. I will look at 100 books of tafsir. Thumma as'alullah, after I've read that and I've come across 100 aqwal and 100 views on this ayah, then I turn to Allah. Wa aqulu, I said to him, Ya mu'allima Dawood, the one who taught Dawood, alimni, teach me. Wa ya mufahima Sulayman, and the one who made Sulayman understand, fahimni, make me understand. Wa kuntu adhabu ila al-masjid al-mahjur. He said, I will go to the masjid, nobody there, Ibn Taymiyyah saying. And then what I will do is, wa umarrig wajhi fit turab, and I'll take my face and I will roll it in the dust. Wa as'alu Allah ta'ala, and then I will ask Allah to give me what? I will give me understanding. I will humble myself. Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah, he carried on like that. His matters was just growing. And his affairs were what? His affairs were just growing. Alayhi rahmatullahi. And his honor and his virtue and his knowledge was growing. Ibn Imad said, Az-Zamlakani, who was one of the enemies of Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah, his enemy saying this, he said, وكان إذا سئل, when he would ask, be asked about Shaykh al-Islam, he would say, Ibn Taymiyyah is never asked about a topic. عن فن من العلم, a matter of the religion is never asked to Ibn Taymiyyah, إلا ظن الرائي, except the one who's looking, or السامع, or the one who's listening to Ibn Taymiyyah would think, أنه لا يعرف غير ذلك الفن. This is the only fun and subject that Ibn Taymiyyah knows. He doesn't know any other one. Any issue that was asked to Ibn Taymiyyah, you would think to yourself, he hasn't mastered except this topic. That's what you would think to yourself. Any topic he spoke about, you think he read it last night, he prepared it, he organized it, he put notes together, and now he's talking about it. That's what you would think. He said, "أنه لا يعرف غير ذلك." وحكم أن أحد لا يعرف مثله. And he said, "It's ruled that no one is like Ibn Taymiyyah." وكان الفقهاء من سائر المذاهب, scholars of other madhabs, the Hanafiya, the Malikiya, the Shafi'iya, they used to come to him, and they would sit with him, and he would teach them about their madhab, and the usul of their madhab, and the aqwal in their madhab, and the tarjihat of the madhab, and the qawl which is mu'tamad in that madhab. He would teach them about their madhab that they follow. إِذَا جَالَسُوا اسْتَفَادُوا مِنْ مَذَاهِبِهِمْ. They sat with him, they benefited from him, their madhab. رَحِمَهُ اللَّهُ. وَلَا يُعْرَفُ, it is not known, أَنَّهُ نَاظَرَ أَحَدًا, that Ibn Taymiyyah ever debated anybody. فَانْقَطَعَ مَعْهُ, that his speech cut. He couldn't say anything after that. Never happened. وَلَا تَكَلَّمَ فِي عِلْمٍ, and it never happened that Ibn Taymiyyah spoke about a knowledge from the knowledges that were out there. إِلَّا فَاقَ فِيهِ أَهْلَهُ, except he surpassed those who spoke about it before him. وَاجْتَمَعَ فِيهِ شُرُوطُ الْإِجْتِهَادِ عَلَى وَجْهِهَا, being a mujtahid was all present in him. He said, Dhahabi then said, when he was asked about Ibn Taymiyyah, they said to him, what do you think about Ibn Taymiyyah? He said, هُوَ أَكْبَرُ مِنْ أَنْ أُنَبِّهَ عَلَى سِيرَتِهِ, Ibn Taymiyyah is higher than me to tell people about his biography. He's greater than that. فَلَوْ حَلَفْتُ, but if I swore by Allah, بَيْنَ الرُّكْنِ وَالْمَقَامِ, between the rukun in the Kaaba and the maqam Ibrahim, if I swore between them, swore there, and I took an oath, لَحَلَفْتُ, I would swear, أَنِّي مَا رَأَيْتُ, that I never saw, بِعَيْنَيَّ مِثْلَهُ, anyone like him with my own eyes. وَأَنَّهُ هِي إِبْنُ تَيْمِيَةَ مَا رَأَى مِثْلَهُ مِثْلَ نَفْسِهِ, he never saw anyone like him himself. I swear, I don't think I ever saw anyone like him. He also hasn't seen anyone like him. Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah ta'ala. ولذلك Shaykh al-Islam, as we're going to take soon inshallah ta'ala, when he went to Egypt to speak to Nasir al-Qalawun, to bring the army for the Muslims, to defend the Muslims in Dimashq against the Tatar, Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah, when he went there and he brought the ayatul jihad and he spoke about the ahkam of jihad and what the Muslims need to do for their Muslims and honor and freedom, Shaykh al-Islam, when he spoke, Ibn al-Daqiq al-Eid was in the gathering, he was sitting. Ibn al-Daqiq al-Eid, right? Was in the gathering sitting. He saw Shaykh al-Islam come in and talk. And when he finished, Shaykh al-Islam finished what he wanted to say, they said to him, do you want to say anything? He said, wallahi, I don't have anything to say. I saw a man, وضع الله العلم بين أصبعيه بين عينيه, I saw a man, Allah placed knowledge بين عينيه, before his eyes. All of knowledge was presented in front of him. يأخذ ما شاء, he takes what he wishes, ويترك ما شاء, and he will leave off what he doesn't need to use for now. That's what I saw from Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah, he said, رحمه الله. Ibn al-Daqiq al-Eid, rahimahullah, older than Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah, said this about him, alayhi rahmatullah. Shaykh al-Islam, how did he look? Kada abyad, Shaykh was white. Aswad al-Ra'si wal-Lihya, his beard, even when he died, was white, is black. No white entered it. He didn't get stressed. And that's powerful. A man who went through what he went through, but his beard and his hair was still black. Alayhi rahmatullah. He used to let his hair grow ila shahm udhunayhi, up to his earlobes. Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah. Ka'anna aynahu, if he looked at you, it was like his eyes were two tongues that were talking to you. It's like when he looked at you, he was talking to you. Rahimahullah. Rib'ata min al-rijali. They have been saying this. He was an average heighted person. He wasn't too tall and he wasn't too short. He was an average heighted person. Ba'ida ma bayna man kibayhi. His shoulders, they were far from each other. Rahimahullah ta'ala. Rahmatan wasi'a. Jahwariyu salt. If he spoke, he was loud. He wouldn't need no microphone or anything. He's very loud in his speech. Sari' al-qira'ah. Ibn Taymiyyah, if he reads from somewhere, his reading was so fast. Lidalika Ibn Taymiyyah never wrote something and he couldn't read his own handwriting. He had Ibn Rushayq, who was his student, was the only person who could read Ibn Taymiyyah's handwriting. No one else. He couldn't read his own handwriting. He used to write fast and he never looked at back what he wrote. If he read, he would read so fast, rahimahullah rahmatan wasi'ah, and he would not do any grammatical mistakes when he's reading. Ta'tarih al-hidda. Underline this point. Ibn Taymiyyah was a bit harsh. He had this hidda in him sometimes, toughness. Sometimes anger may overcome him, rahimahullah. And this is one of the reasons why his enemies increased a bit. Jealousy was one, and the fact that sometimes Shaykh al-Islam, when he wrote harsh. His writing was harsh. لكن يقهرها, but Ibn Dhahabi says, but what would overcome that is his forbearance. He had tolerance. Anything people said to him, he would tolerate. He had tolerance. ولم أرى مثله. I never saw anyone like him in how he used to seek help from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's how he looked. Ibn Taymiyyah lived at a time when the Islamic government was very weak. في حالة الضعف والتمزق الشديد. Islamic government was very low. The Muslims were suffering. And Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah was a person respected. But the khilaf of the Muslims, the haiba and the honor was going, was dying. And the weakness was growing in the Muslims. Muslims were being killed and massacred all over the place. Enemies would come in, destroy the Muslims. It reached a level where the Tatar woman would say to a Muslim man, sit here, I'm going to get my sword to kill you. And the Muslim would wait for her. She would go and she would bring her sword and she would kill him. The reason why he would wait for her is because he knew if he ran, she would get him and kill his family. That's the dhul and the humiliations that the Muslims were in, rahimahullah ta'ala. What role did Shaykh al-Islam take in this regard? How was his position regarding rahimahullah rahmatan wasi'ah? Shaykh al-Islam was an alim who fought with his pen, he fought with his sword, rahimahullah, combined between that. Ibn Taymiyyah heard that the Sultan Ghazan, the Tatar leader, now Ghazan and his army, they claimed to be Muslims. They said, we're Muslims. So when they claimed to be Muslims, Shaykh al-Islam ibn, the forefathers of the Tatar weren't Muslims. So Shaykh al-Islam heard that they wanted to come to Dimashq and they wanted to kill the Muslims. So Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, when the information reached him, فقام من فوري, straight away he stood up. Rahimahullah ta'ala. فوصل, when the news reached him, and he urged the Muslims to wake up and not to have weakness and cowardness in them. Rahimahullah rahmatan wasi'a. And he said, come with courage if it's needed. Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah then went to Ghazan, knocked on his door. The Tatar, no one goes to them. No one talks to them. The Muslim Khilaf, all of them can't come anywhere close to the Mongolians. Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah entered onto him. And when he entered into him, the leader waqa'a fi qalbihi hayba. He venerated and started to respect the Shaykh rahimahullah as soon as he saw him. And the Shaykh rahimahullah came close to him. And he said to him, rahimahullah, he said to him, you claim to be a Muslim. And your forefathers were all non-believers, kuffar. None of them were Muslims. They had more of honesty than you do. You don't fulfill the contracts that you made with the Muslims. You come into the Muslims, and then you want to, you come to the Muslim land, and you break the uhud and the mawathiq that you took with them, the covenants that you took with them. When Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah spoke, and he was talking, the people who were with him, his students, they grabbed the side of their garments and they pulled it together. They were scared that the blood that's going to come from Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah's neck is going to be stricken and killed, is going to go in their clothing. So they're trying to go as further away from him and trying to free themselves from being associated with him. Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah, then they brought close to him food and they said, eat. And he said, no, I'm not going to eat. How am I going to eat food you stole and you took and you robbed from the people? This is the people's wealth and the people's money. You cooked it and you're bringing it to us and you want us to eat it? He said, I'm not going to eat this food of yours. Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah. Then Ghazan said, okay, make dua for us. To Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah. Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah said, okay. He said, Allahumma, oh Allah, in kunta ta'lamu, if you know that this man Ghazan is a person who's fighting, litakuna kalimatullahi al-uliya, he's fighting for the word of Allah to be high. Fa'ayyitu, support him, oh Allah. Wansurhu, give him victory. Wa in kana lil mulki wa dunya, if he only wants dunya and he's running after leadership and he wants to get number, faf'al bihi wasna, destroy him and let him not lift a head. Destroy him. Ghazan was only saying, Ameen, Ameen, Ameen. رحمه الله تعالى ولذلك جمال الدين ابن أنجا he said كان الشيخ الإسلام ابن تيمية يقول لن يخاف الرجل غير الله شيخ الإسلام ابن تيمية said no one fears other than Allah إلا لمرض في قلبه except there's an illness in his heart فإن رجلا شكى إلى أحمد بن حنبل a man came to Imam Ahmad and he complained to him خوفه من بعض الولاة that he was scared of some of the leaders and he said to him لو صححت لم تخف أحدا if you were correct and your heart was good, then you would never have feared anyone. You only feared Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then when Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, the Ghazan leader said to Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, okay, I will not bring any army to you, and I'm not going to enter Dimashq, I'll leave you guys alone. Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah went back, he told the people, don't worry. It wasn't very long, when the year was 700, it reached Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, that the Tatar are coming in and that they've chosen to break the covenant and the promise that they made. Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, he played his role again. What he played was, the leader of the Muslim Khilafah was situated in where? It was situated in Misr. Nasiruddin al-Qalawun was the Sultan of the Muslims at that time. Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, he took a horse from Dimashq. This horse that he took, rahimahullah, it was horses that we would say it's based on speed. You take it, it goes fast. When the horse gets tired, there's another horse waiting for you. You jump on the other horse. And that's how it goes. It's called Barid. It's not meant to waste time. He took that, rahimahullah ta'ala. He went to Nasiruddin al-Qalawun and he spoke to him. He said to him, what's happening to the people of Sham? It's upon you guys as those leaders to defend them and support them. Allah has made it upon you, leaders over them. Rahimahullah, rahmatan wasi'ah. Forget the fact that you guys are leaders over them. If you weren't leaders over them, and you had no control over them, if Muslims asked you for help, you need to help them. Because Allah said in the Quran, فَإِنْ إِسْتَنْصَرُوكُمْ فِي الدِّينِ فَعَلَيْكُمُ النَّصْرُ If they ask you for help and they call for you, then upon you is to give them help and support. What about if you're their leaders and you're in charge of them? He said, you have to help them. Rahimahullah, rahmatan wasi'ah. And the Shaykh urged that the leaders help. And no doubt, the leader, Nasiruddin al-Qalawud, prepared the army and the army went forward. When the army came forward, Nasiruddin al-Qalawud became cold-feeted. Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah went back to him and spoke to him again and the army went forward. The quwwah of Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah was that the fighting took place in Ramadan when the year was 702. And Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah, when the armies met and the Tatar on the other side, and Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah was here, Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah said to his brother, where do you think the Tatar is most weakest? Like, where do you see them to be most weakest? And they pointed towards the direction and he said, inshallah, I'll go from there then. Hakadha he was, his shuja'ah and his bravery, rahimahullah, rahmatan wasi'ah. When Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah finished with the Tatar, there were a group of Ta'ifat al-Rafida who were on top of a mountain, who were the ones who were giving the news to the Tatar. And they were the ones who were taking the Muslims, they were sending it to the Tatar. So what Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah did was, on the way back from the army of the Tatar, he went on the hill, brought them all down, rahimahullah, and he fought against them until he gave victory to the religion. Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah was really tested. Really tested. Rahimahullah, rahmatan wasi'a. If a person can be said that he spent his majority of his time in prison, he did. Rahimahullah, rahmatan wasi'a. And the reason why Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah did is because of what he believed and what he called to. And everybody, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes for him who calls to the truth, who propagates the truth, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes him lisana hasood, a tongue that has envy and jealousy and hate towards him. So Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah did. Rahimahullah rahmatan wasi'a. Some people just hated him. One of the people who gave a fatwa and said that Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah needs to be killed is Ibn Makhluf al-Maliki. He said, "Uqtul ibn Taymiyyah wa damuhu ala unuqi." He said, "Anyone, I've given you guys the fatwa to go and kill Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, and I will speak on your behalf the Day of Judgment." Gave that fatwa. And that fatwa was sa'id. Don't think it was a joke. This is a fatwa from a mufti of the country. So because of that, Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, he was imprisoned. Rahimahullah. The second reason why Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, there was a lot of hostility and hate towards him. As I said to you before, it was a bit tough. Rahimahullah. In the way he spoke. وَلِذَلِكَ أَبُو حَيَّانَ الْأَنْدُلُسِي, the great grammarian, he said, who loved Ibn Taymiyyah. He really loved him. He praised him a lot. And he even made poetry in praise of Ibn Taymiyyah. He met Ibn Taymiyyah one time and he sat with him. And he had so much love for him. And then a discussion went on. And Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah, having that in him, what he did was he spoke very harsh to Abu Hayyan al-Andalusi. And he spoke very harsh to him. And when he spoke harsh to him, he said to him, مَا كَانَ سِيبَوَيْهِ نَبِيُّ الْوَحِيِ. Sibawayh is not the prophet of grammar. And Abu Hayyan al-Andalusi, his knowledge is nahu, grammar. So this hurt him. And he said, وَلَا كَانَ مَعْصُومًا. Sibawayh wasn't infallible. بَلْ أَخْطَأَ, he made mistakes in his kitab, فِي ثَمَانِينَ مَوْضُعًا, 80 places which I've noted down, Ibn Taymiyyah said. لَا تَعْرِفُهُ أَنْتَ, you don't know it. وَلَا سِيبَوَيْه, and Ibn Sibawayh doesn't know that he did that mistake. And Abu Hayyan al-Andalusi, this hit his heart. He loved Ibn Taymiyyah. This hurt him. And then he mentions that was my reason why I boycotted him. And I never spoke to Ibn Taymiyyah after that. ولذلك in his kitab al-Bahr, his Bahr al-Muhit, Abu Hayyan al-Andalusi, he took his time out to refute Ibn Taymiyyah wherever opportunity he got. He refuted him. Rahimahullahu, rahmat al-wasi'ah. So those were the two reasons why Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah was given hard time, rahimahullah. One of the things that Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah suffered because of it was a question came to him from a place called Humata. A people came and they asked him a question. When the year was 698, and Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah gave a fatwa according to what he knew. And this was what's known as what? Bil fatwa al-hamawiyyah al-kubra. He gave fatwa. And he spoke about the issue of Allah's names and attributes. And he stayed away from the babu ta'wil wa ta'atil that they fall into. But when he gave that answer, Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, he got troubled because of that. And because of that, debates took place based on two books of his. Al-Fatawa al-Hamawiyyah and his Al-Aqidat al-Wasitiyyah. He debated, rahimahullah, many debates that wouldn't stop kept coming to him. Rahimahullah, rahmatan wasi'ah. One of the famous debates that he went into is the debate that took place between him, the Ahmadiyyat al-Rifa'iyyah. The Rifa'iyyah were a Sufi group who claimed that they don't have to worship Allah anymore. Khalas. They don't have to. They've reached that level of wa'bud rabbaka hatta ya'tiyaka al-yaqeen. They've reached certainty. So they don't need to worship Allah. So they stop worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Shaykh al-Islam said, I'll debate with you. But there's something that these Ahmadiyyat al-Rifa'iyyah used to do, which is they used to go into fire and the fire wouldn't burn them. It wouldn't burn them. So the Ammatul Nas used to say, look, karamat. Karamat. So Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, as he was debating with them, they started doing that in front of him. Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah said, okay, no problem. He gave them a vinegar. He said, you have to shower with the vinegar. And then you guys and me, we all go into the fire. I'll see who it burns. Because they used to put something on, which would prevent them from the fire. So they refused to do that. And they spoke to him privately. They said, "Leave us alone. What do you want from us? Leave us alone." He said, "No. Wash your fingers. If you don't want to wash, burn your whole bodies, wash your fingers and place it in the fire after washing it with the vinegar." They said, no, leave us alone. We told you, leave us alone. The night before, Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah spent the whole night begging Allah. Every time he went for a munadara and a debate, Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah, every time he would ask Allah at night, the whole night, he would beg Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give him victory. Rahimahullah, rahmatan wasi'ah. Brothers, Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah's life is very, very long. Alayhi rahmatullah. And it's a person whose many things can be taken from it. But one of the things that touched me from his life was when Ibn Taymiyyah got arrested on his last final occasions, and he came out because he built a very strong bond with Nasruddin al-Qalawun. And Nasruddin al-Qalawun stepped down from Egypt for a period of time. And that time, Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah, Nasruddin al-Qalawun was not the leader. Ibn Taymiyyah was really hurt because he spent a lot of time in prison. He was in prison in Iskandariya. He was in prison in Qahira. He spent time in prison. And they gave fatwas of his killing. But Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, he managed, Nasruddin al-Qalawun managed to come back in position. And when he did, who's got the upper hand now? Ibn Taymiyyah did. Nasruddin al-Qalawun personally requested for the freedom of Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah. And Ibn Taymiyyah came out. And Nasruddin al-Qalawun was waiting for Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah in the front of his qasr, his building, waiting for Ibn Taymiyyah to come. And he shook his hand, kissed him on the forehead. And then he sat down and he showed him all the fatwas of those who said you need to be killed and what they said about him. He was trying to hint, give me the green lights, I will deal with these people, all of them. And Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah said something. He said, "These are Ahlul Ilm. These are people of knowledge. Whether I agree with them or I disagree with them. If you kill them, who are you going to exchange them with?" And then Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah said something powerful. "I have freed everybody who's caused me harm. I have freed them from any of my hukuk." ولذلك Ibn Makhluf al-Maliki, who gave the fatwa of the killing of Ibn Taymiyyah, he said, "May Allah have mercy on Ibn Taymiyyah. When we had the ability over him, we harmed him. But when he had it over us, he forgave us." And this is the characteristics of a person who the issue is not personal for him. And the qadiyah is not him. He knows it's not about him. But the matter for him is what? Deen, rahimahullah. ولذلك when Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah's greatest enemy died, Ibn Makhluf al-Maliki died, and Ibn Taymiyyah was told about it, they gave him the good glad tidings. They said, "Look, your enemy's dead, alhamdulillah, relax, don't worry, he's dead." And then he said, "Atubashiruni bimawti rajulin muslim?" "Are you going to give me the glad tidings of the death of a Muslim?" He stood up and he went to the children of this man. He went to his house, he grabbed his children, and he said to them, "What you need to know is I am your father from today onwards. I take the place of your father." Rahimahullah, rahmatan wasi'ah. He knew where the discussion lies, where the niqash was, and where it was haqqul muslim ala akhihi al-muslim. He knew that, rahimahullah, rahmatan wasi'ah. ولذلك, look at the statement that he said, rahimahullah. He said, in his last, he said, "Qad ahlaltu, I have freed kullu ahadin, everybody, mimma bayni wa baynahu, that which is between me and him, إلا من كان عدوا لله ورسوله," except whoever is an enemy to Allah and His Messenger. That's what it meant for him, rahimahullah ta'ala. And he walked away from any person being killed or being harmed because of him, rahimahullah rahmatan wasi'ah. Because Ibn Taymiyyah spent 7 years and seven nights in Egypt, he wasn't with his mom. And there were letters he wrote for his mom. I advise you guys to listen to that letter he wrote for his mom and his brothers, advising them. And the message shows you how he was an obedient son to his parents, his mother. Ya ikhwa, an alim, when you look at him, he's an alim in all aspects. He's not just in one field that we look at. It's great all over. Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, he got taken in prison and everything got taken away from him. The leader, he took everything from him. He took pens, he took the papers from him because he was writing so much. His enemies did not want him to author anything. They did not want. A man, Al-Khana'i, came out and he made some accusations. Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah refuted him and made a book. And then the book spread amongst the people. And then the Khana'i went to the leader. He said, "How is this man writing? I thought he was prisoned. I thought he was meant to be silent." So they took the pen and papers and everything from him. And Ibn al-Qayyim said, I was in prison with him. And he said he took the Qur'an and he read it from dhahr al-qalb, from the top of his head. And he read it 81 times. رَحِمَهُ اللَّهُ رَحْمَةً وَاسِعَةً Until he came to the ayah, إِنَّ الْمُتَّقِينَ فِي جَنَّاتِ وَنَهَرٍ فِي مَقْعَدِ صِدْقٍ عِنْدَ مَلِيكٍ مُقْتَدِرٍ When he reached that ayah, Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, he died and he passed away. Everybody came to know about his death. Scholars, Al-Imam al-Dhahabi, Ibn Kathir, Ibn Abd al-Hadi, Abu al-Hajjaj al-Mizzi, all of them participated in his burial. ولذلك شيخ الإسلام الإمام أحمد رحمه الله, what did he say? Between us and the Mubtadi'a is the burial day. Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah was the second most largest person's janazah after Ahmad ibn Hanbal رحمه الله. لم يرى مثله, wasn't seen the likes of it. His enemies came, the leaders came, everybody participated. And he spent his life in prison and he stood up for what he believed. One of the reasons why he got in prison, his last reasons he got in prison was two things. The issue of ta'liq al-talaq, and he was requested on many occasions to not stop talking about it. And he looked at everybody and he said, I will never. They said to him about, what about the issue of shaddu al-rihal? Go and visiting the graves. Going from one country. He said, I'm not going to stop talking about that issue. And because of those two issues, he refused to stop talking about, he got taken into prison. And they asked him before he went to prison, do you regret talking about it? He said, la wallah. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ وَلَقَدْ أَخَذَ اللَّهُ مِيثَاقَ وَلَقَدْ أَخَذَ اللَّهُ مِيثَاقَ الَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْكِتَابَ لَتُبَيِّنُنَّهُ لِلنَّاسِ وَلَا تَكْتُمُونَ He said, Allah took a covenant with the people of knowledge that they will clarify the truth and they will not hide it. And he said, مَنْ سُئِلَ عَنْ عِلْمٍ فَكَتَمَهُ Anyone who's asked about a knowledge and he hides it, he will come the day of judgment with a what? بِلِجَابٍ بِالنَّارِ The rope that's used for the horse is going to be placed in his mouth. So he, rahimahullah, he died. I'm going to conclude, inshallah ta'ala. Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, when he died, his books were banned. No one was allowed to republish them, and they were not allowed to be spread, and everything, it got banned. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He always wants something, it will happen, and no one can stop it. Inshallah ta'ala, I'm going to mention some of the scholars who stood up in this early time, in our time, who stood up to work, bring out the works of Ibn Taymiyyah. The first one is Muhammad Siddiq Hassan Khan, from India, rahimahullah ta'ala. Siddiq Hassan Khan is an imam and he did khidmah for the works of Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah. Siddiq Hassan Khan lived at the time of Nadir Hussain al-Dihlawi and Abdul Hayy al-Laknawi in India. They were all at the same time. And Shaykh Siddiq Hassan Khan, he married a princess. He married a princess. She was very rich. He took her money and he spread it with authoring the works of Ibn Taymiyyah, rahimahullah ta'ala. Rahmatan wasi'a, and spreading the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Siddiq Hassan Khan. There's a very fascinating story of Siddiq Hassan Khan, rahimahullah. He has a book called Ad-Dinul Khalis. I advise you guys to read it. It's a 3-volume book, Siddiq Hassan Khan. It's called what? Ad-Dinul Khalis. He mentions the reason why he wrote that book. He said, I was on a boat one day, I was going Hajj, and as I was on the boat, people then started to call on to other than Allah. He said, I realized, what are these people doing? And so he authored that book, Ad-Dinul Khalis. Rahimahullah. It's an amazing story. We'll try to read it. From the scholars is Abu Tib Ata'ullahi Al-Hanif, who's a great Indian scholar who died the year 187 Hijriya. And the Indian scholars were the early scholars who actually had a publishing house to publish books. Also, Muhammad Rashad Salim, who was a student in Cambridge University in the early 50s. He's the one who done the tahqiq of the kitab Al-Istiqamah, and the Kitab al-Safadiyya, and the Kitab Minhaj al-Sunnah al-Nabawiyya, and Dar'u Ta'arud al-Aql wal-Naql. And I think, if I'm not wrong, Talbis, Iblis. All of those books, he's the one who done tahqiq of it. In the 50s, he used to go in the UK, and he used to carry and gather, and in Europe, he would go and gather all the manuscripts of Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah's books, and he would work towards establishing them. Muhammad Hamid al-Fiqhi, the great Egyptian scholar. Muhammad Muhyiddin Abdul Hamid, the Sharih of the Kitab Tuhfatu Tuhfatu Sariya, which is the Sharh Muqaddimah Al-Ajrumiyya, the one who explained it, Muhammad Muhyiddin Abdul Hamid. He also was from the scholars who stood up to do tahqiqat of the works of Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah. Muhammad Rashid Rida, the author of the Mujallat Al-Manar, who Shaykh Albani said, because of this man, Muhammad Rashid Rida, I started to go for hadith. Muhammad Rashid Rida was from the scholars who made sure that he brought the works of Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah. Muhibbuddin al-Khatib, rahimahullah, he has a good kitab called Khutut al-Arida. He's a great scholar, that is students of knowledge and ulama know him. from Egypt, Mahmoud Shukri al-Alusi in Egypt, was from the scholars who stood up to make sure he published the works of Shaykh Islam Taymiyyah. Muhammad Bahjat al-Athari from Dimashq, Jamaluddin al-Qasimi, Muhammad Bahjat al-Baydar, who was the student of Jamaluddin al-Qasimi, Tahir al-Jazairi, who is a scholar who died in the year 1920. He has a kitab called Tawjih al-Nazar ila Mustalah Ahl al-Athar, something like that. Two-volume book, very nice. Muhammad Nasiruddin al-Albani, rahimahullah. And last but not least, Abdul Rahman Yahya al-Muallimi. Abdul Rahman Yahya al-Muallimi, he went to Hyderabad, Deccan. He married an old Indian woman. He's a Yemeni originally. Rahman Yahya al-Muallimi. And when they asked him, why did you marry an old woman? You're a very young man. He said, I don't want to have children. And nor did I want to be in a serious relationship. The woman is excessively old. So Shaykh al-Islam, Shaykh Muhammad Yahya al-Muallimi was a sahib ilm. So he used to stay in Mecca. He had a maktabatul haram where he used to sit. And he wrote many books. From the books that he wrote is the kitab Raf'ul Ishtibah, which is known as Risalatul Ibadah, where he talks about the concept of ibadah is. He authored another kitab called At-Tankir Bima Fi Ta'nib Al-Kawthari Min Al-Abatil, where he refutes Muhammad Zahid Al-Kawthari. And another kitab where he called it Al-Anwar Al-Kashifa, where he refutes Abu Rayya, who wrote a kitab called Adwa'us Sunnah. This kitab, Tankil, is categorized into three. The first one, he talks about the tarajim of the ulama, then he talks about the fuqaha and the aimatul fiqh, and then last but not least, he talks about matters of aqidah. And the last part is actually separately published. It's called Al-Qa'id ila Tasheeh Al-Aqa'id. And this is the tahqiq of Sheikh Muhammad Nasiruddin Albani, Maktabat al-Islamiyya published it. All of these ulama, Wajahabidatul Nuqad, they spent their time bringing out the works of Sheikh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah. My advice to you, brothers, is that every one of you are going to come to this world and you're going to leave. Ask yourself, what have you served this deen? What have you done for your religion? And what have you brought for it? Don't be a person who came to this world and your presence and your absence is the same. Your presence and your absence is the same. Every one of you I'm looking at here is very young. And many of the scholars, ya ikhwa, they never embarked on the first stages of their life. They did not embark on becoming scholars or people of knowledge. If you look at Imam al-Dhahabi, he was an Imam fil Qira'at. Dhahabi, that was his field. He has the big great book called Ma'rifatu Qurra'i al-Kibar. Dhahabi was a scholar in Qira'at, but one day he was writing something and Al-Barzali, rahimahullah, saw Dhahabi writing. And guess what he said to him? What did he say to him? Your handwriting is like the handwriting of the scholars of Hadith. And that's it. Dhahabi's life changed and he became a what? A scholar in Hadith. He wrote his book, Sir Alam al-Nubala. And then he's got a kitab called Al-Muqidha fi Mustalahi Al-Hadith. He's an Imam in Hadith now. He has ta'liqat on Imam Abu Abdullah Hakim in Isaburi in his Mustadrak in Hadith. Just by somebody seeing your handwriting, tells you got good handwriting, your handwriting is like the scholars of Hadith. And then you embark on it, shows what? وَمَنْ تَكُنِ الْعِلْمِ عِلْيَا هِمَّةَ نَفْسِي فَكُلُّ الَّذِي يَلْقَى فِيهِ مُحَبَّبُ. High aspiration. Are you with me, brothers? And the poet said, فَمَا حَوَى الْغَايَاتُ فِي أَلْفِ سَنَةٍ شَخْصٌ فَخُذْ مِنْ كُلِّ فَنٍّ أَحْسَنَهُ بِحِفْظِ مَتْنِ جَامِعٍ لِلرَّاجِحِ تَأْخُذُهُ عَلَى مُفِيدِ النَّاصِحِ. Memorize, understand, and implement. That's where people pass. There's no one Allah raised greater than the people of knowledge. Wallahi, Allah raised their status, station. Allah took them as witnesses. You take a witness as a reliable person, right? Allah said in the Quran, شهد الله أنه لا إله إلا هو والملائكة وأولو العلم قائما بالقسط. Allah says, they are my witness. The scholars and the angels are my witness that I am the only one who deserves to be worshipped. That shows you the station of the people of knowledge and how high they are, how great they are. And إخواني, إن لم تكونوا مثلهم فتشبهوا إن التشبه بالكرام فلاح. If you can't be like these scholars, you can't reach that level, then try to mimic them. Pretend, act like them. For verily, acting like the people of knowledge is what? It's a virtue in and within itself. It's a virtue. Any mistake, errors, shortcoming, faults that I might have come with whilst I was talking, فَإِنَّهُ مِنِّي وَمِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ وَاللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ بَرِئَانِ مِنْهُ. It's from me as shaytan, and Allah and His Messenger are free from it. سُبْحَانَكَ اللَّهُمَّ بِحَمْدِكَ أَشْهَدُ أَنْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ أَسْتَغْفِرُكَ أَتُوبُ إِلَيْهِ.